You have some of you that are listening to me here, and you know I'm telling you the truth. You've lived your entire lives as somebody else, all because that's the only way you can feel as though you are going to be blessed, and it's wrong.
Amen.
It's wrong. Young people starting off your life, it's wrong. You have to grow up being who you are, and I'm not talking about the bad stuff. I'm talking about the fact that God has created you to be a certain way. There's a reason why you are quick-witted. There's a reason why you are a deep thinker. There's a reason why sometimes you do things a little bit slower. And when you become what other people want you to be, you will resent those that are allowed to be themselves. Because not everybody that is themselves is a good person. So Isaac, to me, he's a little bit of a joker. Jacob comes before Esau does, right? The meal is cooked. The thing tastes good. Let me ask you this quick question, Sister Levy. Are you telling me that Esau is going to cook some food, and Jacob is going to cook the same type of food, and it's going to taste the same way when mom is the one who cooks it for Jacob? I don't know, follow me. Because here's the challenge now. Jacob is now about to feed his father from a pot of food that his mother has cooked. Father eats from that pot and says to himself, I don't know whose food this is. In other words now, he's now eaten something that he knows his wife has cooked. Jacob is bringing it, but he's claiming now that because he can't see, he doesn't know. Are you with me so far? Isaac is using now his age and his inability to see to give him a pass from saying, Jacob, I know it's you. Is it clear so far? So now watch what happens. If he didn't know that it was somebody else and not Esau, why all the questions? Why would you ask so many questions if you know that it is Esau? You know what I think? I think like Abraham, in some senses, Isaac was a coward and he did not want to admit that he really wanted to give the blessing to Jacob because he knew what he would do with it, but he didn't have the heart to tell Esau, you're not ready for it. Sibling rivalry happens when parents are unwilling to admit to their children that that which you want, you're not ready for it yet. And then you spin it and you make it about the mother when it's really you as a man who won't stand. Yes. Pastor Nichols, we talk about this all the time. And if I'm wrong, and you better affirm me this time, because I gave you a high five the last time and I got in trouble when I got it home. So let me come closer to you. Things, Pastor Nichols, to be, I believe, is a man.
Yes.
A war. It is hard to be a man because when things are going right, it's not a man. But when things are going wrong, it is the man. Yeah. know what? I should have saved that for another sermon. It didn't really fit right there. Isaac should be willing to admit to the son that he loves, you won't know what to do with this birthright, so I'm passing it along beyond you, not because you're blessed, but because you can't handle this. Now, why are they unable to do this? That's the question. We've got to get there, and so we're here right now. Why doesn't he do this? Because their parenting is a parenting of avoidance. And because they've been avoiding conflict all of their lives, they don't have the skill set to sit down with their children at an early age and say to them, here is what the Lord told me, and even though you might take it as a slap in the face, we're going to trust God. Because you know, when you tell people the truth in love early, they will be able to receive it better than when you try to tell them the truth in the moment where the conflict will come. Because now you're only telling me the truth in response to a situation, which means then that if you could avoid it to tell me the truth, you would have done so, and it's wrong. It's wrong. So now watch this. Crazy. Rebecca further solidifies this division in her home, because once she realizes how angry Esau is with Jacob, she doesn't sit the two of them down together. She tells the one who she really loves to flee to safety, and then tries to make the excuse that she's concerned whether or not both of them will be lost in the day. Why is Esau so angry? I'm glad you asked. Esau is angry because he's been lied to for his whole entire life. And even though he's been lied to, here's the challenge now that pushes him over the top. He's been lied to, but loved by his father, but his father is now on the verge of death, and he knows that his mother doesn't love him.
Mercy.
So when his father dies, he will become like Ishmael.
Wow.
Right? How do I know this? Well, I'm glad you asked. Because after his father dies, Esau goes to do what? Live with Ishmael. Yeah, they go and they connect. Read it. Esau now is partnered again with Ishmael because the both of them know exactly what it feels like to be rejected by the father.
Mercy.
Now watch this. Now that Esau and Ishmael are together, they now come to Toronto East Seventh-day Adventist Church. And because everybody knows that they are outcasts in their families, rather than embrace them and show them love, they alienate them further by never allowing them on the microphone because their family is jacked up. But the problem is that Esau and Ishmael are survivors, which means that they've learned how to live with less, and you can't work around them even though they're angry. So guess what? You have to work with them in the church. You don't want to work with them in the church, but every Sabbath they're female are greeters at the door. And on one Sabbath morning, while they're getting ready to come to church, they remember the pain of always having to feel like they're less than, and so instead of greeting at the door properly, they're angry, they're hurt, and now here you come in with a short skirt. I don't know, I'm making this thing practical. I don't want to shoot this over your head, I want to shoot it so that it hits both of our hearts. Because this thing called family impacts us in our own personal space, but you don't change who you are just because you're in a building. So now guess what? Jacob, who's gone out there and married the wrong women, still has his mother's love. He's on the praise team. He's on the prayer team. He's on the personal ministry. And all I get to do because of what my father did and my mother's rejection, you get to greet. And then when we come together and we try to figure out how we put together our church's officers together, we put the hurt in people in the corner, and we put the shady people in the spotlight. One of the things that I have to say to you, for those of you that are visiting, after the sermon, you will say to yourself, wow, he sure is a nice guy. But during the preaching moment, he's not so much of a nice guy. I'm nice both of the time. It's just I'm telling you the truth because I understand what it is that we do because of sin. So now watch what happens. Instead of the shady coming together with the hurt to focus on Christ, they never actually come together to make this thing work. So they come to church every Sabbath because they believe in the Ten Commandments. They believe in the Sabbath day. But here's the problem. They don't want to be at the door anymore. But they don't want to feel like they have to beg for our affection to get on the mic. So you know what happens? We develop cliques. Because you know, when Esau goes to see Ishmael, that is what is called a subculture. They're actually forming another community within the community. Does that happen here at East? Amen, Pastor Anderson. We cannot be a sub-community in a community that is led by one who is Christ. Wrap this thing up. No, I don't want to yet. I'm right where I need to be this particular Sabbath day. Jacob and Esau are blood. Through Christ's sacrifice on the cross, we are all blood. Well, if that is true, then whenever we find that there are individuals that are separate from us, why do we affirm that by pretending like it doesn't happen? How do we fix it, Pastor Anderson? I'm glad you asked. When was the last time we said to ourselves, let's invite somebody who doesn't fit in? Because here's what I'm learning, brethren. That when you invite those that don't fit in, that you identify, when they come to your home, they're probably a lot like you, which is why you identify them. All right, Pastor Anderson, we get it. You thumped us in our head enough for the week. Tell us, how do we fix this thing? How do we fix this thing? I'm glad you asked. Years have passed. Jacob and Esau have been separate. It's time for them now to become reconciled. Jacob has to wrestle with the angel by night. Esau has to wrestle with God through his brain. But either way, the change catalyst for them being able to reconcile is God. How do you remove sibling rivalry, church? It's simple. Listen to what God has to say about reconciling with people that you are divided from. Why do you sound like this today, Pastor Anderson? I'm glad you asked. I sound like this today because it's time where we as a church stop coming into the building week after week, knowing that we are separate as brothers and sisters and trying to sing louder and teach longer and pray with more earnesty. God does not want those things. He wants us to be reconciled one to another. And you know what? Let me just say this. My honeymoon is over. So if you hear me say it, it's only because I'm trying to be humorous. I now see some of you when you're leaving the building and somebody's coming your way. I've seen you go down the other alternative pew. I've seen it. I've seen somebody coming towards you to say hello, and you pretend like you were distracted and now you have to go to the powder room. I've seen it.
Mercy.
I've seen it. You cannot avoid conflict. You just can't. And even if the person that you should make amends to dies, if your spiritual antennas are up high enough, you will find that the Lord will bring another person or persons into your life that will force you to have to deal with your past before you move on to your future.
Amen.
A blessing only becomes a curse when you refuse, and I refuse, to be like God. How do I know this? He came to his own, and his own received him not. And yet, it doesn't change the fact that he has to go all the way to the cross so that there can be no more division between Isaac and Ishmael, Jacob and Esau, and Joseph and their sons, because at the end of the day, cannot do church when you have sibling rivalry. Don't wait till you're old. Don't manipulate from spouse to spouse. Be honest with your children and pray that the Lord will give you his heart. You deserve all of our praise, all of our praise. You deserve all of our praise. I'm only singing to give somebody time to come forward. This message was for more than one of you, so step out of your seat. I want to pray for you today. All of our praise, all of our praise, oh, you deserve all of our praise, all of our praise. Come on, church, step out of your seats. We will be reconciled this year. We will be reconciled this year. We will be a stronger family this year. We will forgive one another. Step out of your seats and come. We will say that we're sorry. We will parent better. We will pray more. We will be led by the Spirit, because at the end of the day, family first. Come on, step out. You deserve all of our praise, all of our praise. Oh, you deserve all of our praise, all of our praise. Come on, church, step out. Come on, come on. You deserve, step all the way to the front. All of our praise, all of our praise. Come on, church, wherever you are, step out. Sibling rivalry, we're killing it today. Because God is going to fix our families without us avoiding things. Let's go. Step out. Come on. We deserve. You deserve. And when we change, we can sing this song without reservation. It's hard to praise when your family's messed up. Hard to praise when you don't have a relationship with your brother or your sister. Hard to praise when you don't even like the person you're sitting beside today. So let's sing it and come forward. You deserve all of our praise. Come on, where are you? Come on, step all the way out and come forward. It's you today. Relationships.
Amen.
Authentic ones. Where we can say sorry to one another. Where we can communicate. We're missing it. And I know some of you guys are going to be mad, but I don't care this morning. Abraham's stuff and Isaac's stuff, 3 generations, and that's all I'm talking about this morning. That's just 3 generations worth. And then by the time you get to the New Testament, then you find that all of a sudden, the only people that matter are the Jews. What about the other 11 tribes? What about those that are not Andersons? They matter too. I'm only giving you 1 more minute. We're going to do it this year. God has put it in my heart that we're going to become a stronger family. We're going to put aside some of the petty stuff that we have been doing. And it's not going to be okay to worship when you hate somebody in your heart in this building. You deserve all of my praise,
all of my praise.
Oh, you deserve all of my praise, all of our praise. For those that have come forward this morning, I want to pray for you. Because you know what? One of the things that I can't stand about ministry is that every time I stand up to preach, there is a portion of the sermon that is for me. I am the baby of my family. And whenever you are the baby of your family in many situations, it's hard for individuals to take you seriously not because you're of the individual, but because of your birth order. And so for many years of my life, there have been times where I disliked my own sisters because I wanted the attention that my parents would give to them, not understanding. It's not personal, Andre. You're the baby. And so as you stand here, and I don't want anybody to take this thing and say, make it anything different than what it is. My parents have loved me with an everlasting love, and some of the stuff that I have to deal with is me coming to grips with the fact that I have my own stuff. And now that I'm getting older and I'm in the Word, and God has me pastoring, I'm now beginning to understand that sin is so crippling that you'll be upset with individuals that don't even know that you're mad at them. Let it go. I'll never forget the morning I woke up and God was like, it's not them, Andre. The problem's with you. Really, Lord? Yes. And when he did that for me, you know what I did? I woke up and it was like there was a weight lifted off of my heart and my shoulders. And from that day forward, the only thing that's happening is my relationship with my siblings is getting better and better and better, because I don't want them to go to heaven without me, and I don't want to go to heaven without them, and I don't want us to go to heaven without my family. Sibling rivalry, it's foolishness. Jacob and Esau, they're both blessed. Every single one of you that has stepped out of your seat, you're blessed. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that today, for those that have come forward with heavy hearts, touch them first. We've talked about a lot of heavy things today. And all I'm doing is, I'm asking you, Lord, is help them to forgive. Help them to let it go. It doesn't matter what anybody else is doing. Help them to let it go. I'm praying for this congregation where week after week we talk about being known for love. Help us to not just be sayers, but knowers and doers of that phrase. We need to be known for love. We need to be known as a church where we don't divide people based on brokenness. Because at the foot of the cross, everybody is worth the exact same. So I want to pray, Lord, for every single person that's in this building today, that you would somehow heal us. Heal us from the things that our grandparents and great-grandparents have done to us. Heal us from the choices that we have made. Heal us from the misunderstandings, because sometimes parents are not on the same page. I'm just asking, Lord, heal our families this year, so that when the community comes into this building, they won't come to visit, but they'll come to stay. Why? Because we ask all of these things in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen.